Hello, I'm Sabina O'Hara. Welcome to the Causes Lecture Series. The mission of the College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences is to offer research-based academic and community outreach programs that improve the quality of life and economic opportunity of people and organizations in the District of Columbia, the nation, and the world. Our guest lecturer is David House, a renewable energy expert, designer, poet, and author of Methane Systems, the Complete Biogas Handbook. David is the founder of Earthmind, an educational nonprofit teaching about ecological living, and he's also the designer of a low-cost plastic bag-based biogas digester for equatorial belt countries and the inventor of a patented new technology for cochlear implants. Presently, he's developing a low-cost biogas digester for uses in the United States and other cold weather countries around the world.
I should start by thanking Dr. O'Hara, who set this up, and Greg Howland, who's arranged for this lecture and workshop. If he wasn't here, none of the rest of us would be either. The basics are keep it warm, keep it wet, keep it away from oxygen, and you've got biogas, right? Because it's an absolutely natural process. It's not something that you have to interrupt. If you think about it, ethanol is a process that you have to interrupt because wine never comes out of crushed grapes. You get vinegar ultimately or something else from it. And biodiesel likewise is a transesterification process that as far as I know doesn't occur naturally. All right, so neither of those are like biogas. Biogas just wants to happen. It will happen if you let it. In fact, it's been said that all of us are producing biogas, and there's nothing wrong with that, except releasing it is probably not a good idea. And you can take almost anything that was once alive, you can put it in a container where air can't get in, or gas escape, two conditions. And it's called a digester, this container, this box, this device. You keep it warm. The best is about body temperature. Our body temperature, for a cow, body temperature is 104, 105. But our body temperature, 85 and above is good. Keep it wet, but don't add too much water because the water doesn't really, after a certain point, the water doesn't add anything to the reaction. It just kind of takes up space and it's very hard to heat. Feed it properly, which means that adequate temperatures, about a 30th of the volume of the digester per day, ought to do it. And a burnable gas will be produced. Biogas is 50 to 70% methane. The rest is carbon dioxide and water vapor, for the most part. Methane is a potent greenhouse gas, as we'll discuss a bit more. But when we make biogas and then burn it or use it as a fuel, it turns into, from CH4, it turns into water and carbon dioxide when we add oxygen and burn it. And that reduces the global warming potential. Now, at this point, I was going to ask for a show of hands. Don't raise your hands. But I was going to ask for a show of hands with regard to how many people believe that there is such a thing as anthropogenic global climate change. Only, I didn't want to embarrass anybody if they didn't. But I was going to suggest that if there is anybody here who doesn't understand anthropogenic global climate change, they might want to expose themselves to a more complete set of facts. And for heaven's sake, stop learning their science from people who keep telling us that they're not scientists. Biogas is one result of a natural process called anaerobic digestion, where microorganisms, they're not bacteria, as we'll cover in the workshop, microorganisms which do not need and might even be poisoned by oxygen, metabolize organic chemicals to make their living. Everybody's got to make a living. In ecology, this is called trophism or trophic levels. So as you may suspect, anaerobic means without oxygen. No air, no gaseous or free oxygen, absent oxygen, whereas aerobic implies the presence of oxygen. So when you make a compost pile, you want to make sure it's aerated. And you can tell whether or not it's aerated by how hot it is, if you've made it properly otherwise. As long as it stays hot, it's got oxygen. And when there is no longer any oxygen, it goes cold. And really the biology shifts in a fairly dramatic way. Because biogas does not require the addition of chemicals, whereas biodiesel does, it uses most fractions of any kind of organic waste, right? Whereas biodiesel uses only the oil. And ethanol uses the sugary portion of whatever you're trying to feed it. But biogas appreciates oils, fats, sugars, carbs, protein, all of it. And so as a consequence, more of the energy that's locked up in all of those different kinds of molecules is released as biogas. Biogas does not require, generally does not require additional energy. If you want to upgrade it to biomethane, which they do a lot in Europe, I don't think it's done in the US, but if you want to upgrade it or do other kinds of fancy things, compress it, what have you, you might have to add energy, but you can use it just the way it comes right out of the tank for almost any thing that you can use natural gas for. So biodiesel has to be further processed. Ethanol must generally be distilled. That means that just in the ordinary course of events, when you're using those kinds of bioenergy, you have to add more energy, which of course at the end will reduce the amount of energy that you have. You might start with a certain gross amount of energy, but then if you have to put energy back into the process, you need to subtract that from what you get at the end. So the energetics of biogas are better than most other forms of energy. Sorry. This is from a study by Roger Sampson. He did his work in Canada, surprisingly. I mean, it's a surprising place for biogas, right, because it's cold. But this is what he found out when he compared different kinds of bioenergy. It was hard to beat pyrolysis or burning, which of course makes sense, right? But other than that, biogas took second and third place, and it beat ethanol all to heck and gone, particularly corn grain ethanol, which is what we use so much of in the U.S. Now, why is that? Well, one would suspect that the fact that Iowa votes in primaries first has something more to do with this than physics, right? I mean, what politician is going to stand up in Iowa and say, I'm going to get rid of ethanol? So there isn't popular imagination a circle of life where the energy of life is provided by the sun. It's converted to the use of everything else that's alive by green plants. It flows through all living things until they die and decompose, returning their borrowed energy and matter to the earth. We're just sort of borrowing all of this stuff for a while. And maybe it looks like this. No, I'm sorry. That's trying to find parking in DC. That's not the circle of life. I apologize. It's some kind of mistake. This is more what circle of life looks like. You'll see this picture in greater context tomorrow, but basically the sun shines on a plant. The plant converts that energy at maybe 2.5% efficiency to carbohydrates and other kinds of chemicals. And then we have primary consumers like that bug, right? A primary consumer is an herbivore. We have secondary consumers like that bird, which probably eats the bug, but it may also eat the plant. And then tertiary consumers, like that boy there, which apparently ate the bird. And then eventually they all die. And those are the black arrows. They die, they decompose, they go back to the dark part of the circle of life. So again, the circle is powered by the sun. It uses green plants, it nourishes all life, and then everything dies and decomposes. It's the part of the circle that we generally do not want to think about, right? Involving, as it does, so many unmentionables, such as poop and death. It's a picture of maggots. You know, I looked for something that was slimier, but it's so hard to get a good picture of something slimy. This is my last job. No, but actually this gentleman probably is earning his living this way. He's sorting through the garbage. This is a job in a lot of countries, you know, because people throw things away and there we go. And this bird probably died from eating that cigarette lighter. Plus, what are there? 2-3 bottle caps and some other things? So there's no death without life, but vice versa. And how should we think about this inevitable part of life, that is excrement, death, and decay? I think this is maybe one reason why biogas isn't more used, because it has to do with those sorts of things. Walt Whitman offered an interesting perspective in a marvelous poem from Leaves of Grass called This Compost. Now I am terrified at the earth. It is that calm and patient. It grows such sweet things out of such corruptions. It turns harmless and stainless on its axis. With such endless succession of diseased corpses, it distills such exquisite winds out of such infused fetor. It gives such divine materials to men and accepts such leavings from them at last. So anaerobic digestion is one of the key players in the dark part of the circle of life. It can therefore help us not recover not only energy but also nutrients, right? This linear progression is the way our society does it, the one on the left here. Right, where we have chemical fertilizers that grow food, which is eaten, where then we discard and so on, and it's usually washed out into some innocent water body of water, and thereby eutrophies and destroys it. What we need to do is complete the circle, you know? And this is not a new thought. There's a wonderful book that you may have heard of called Farmers of 40 Centuries, where F.H. King decided in the early teens of the last century, in the previous millennium, that there was a good possibility, based on what he was seeing in his statistics, that we were going to destroy all of our farmland. And he started looking around and he found that people in China had been farming the same soil for 4,000 years. How did they do that when we weren't being successful at fewer than a century, at less than a century? And so he wrote this marvelous book. It's available online. I scanned it for the guy that runs the website Journey to Forever, so you can find it online. And it's kind of a travel log. It's an interesting sort of combination of science and travel. Besides wasting those nutrients, unless we complete the circles, we're wasting all that embodied energy and that food. There's a lot. And anyone who's ever built a compost pile knows how much energy is available from trash and decomposing garbage. Oh, I'm sorry. My flux capacitor had a problem. So this actually isn't the picture that I was supposed to show you, but it's a picture of me and a couple of my students. Actually, this is the picture I wanted to show you. It's a compost pile. I mean, you imagine that pile is hot enough to steam like that all the way through it. That is a heck of a lot of energy that is being produced, or liberated, really. But it's, of course, kinetic energy. Does anybody understand the difference? Kinetic energy is energy that moves. It's hard to capture. Potential energy is energy that sits and waits for us to do something. If I raise these keys and put them here, then now the keys have a greater potential energy than they did before. Now that energy is kinetic, if the difference makes sense. So the biogas process returns that embodied energy, but not as kinetic energy, not as heat easily lost, rather it's potential fire that's being returned in combustible methane. And it looks like this if you want to think about it. You remember I said the compost pile will grow cold. The biology shifts. Anaerobic digestion does not produce much energy. And so the organisms that are involved, there are some bacteria, but the main organisms that are involved are actually archaea. This is a different kind of life. It's as different as we are. We're closer to fungi than bacteria are to archaea, if that makes sense, and if you look at the tree of life. All right, so aerobic digestion, 60% is cell growth, 40% is heat, methane, none. The methane is produced but it's also consumed right in the compost pile. On the other hand, anaerobic digestion, 10% is cell growth, much less, because it's a physiology that is not as efficient as ours is. But 90% of the energy versus 40 comes back as methane. So you look at that steaming compost pile, right? All of that energy that's being released as steam and heat is going to be returned to us as methane, but actually twice as much plus a skosh, 40 versus 90. But per capita biogas ratios, if you compare, let's say, Germany and other countries in Europe to the U.S., now these statistics are based on some information that was provided to me in a personal communication, and I think that the gentleman was talking just about farm digesters and industrial digesters, i.e. places like cafeterias or places that can food, what have you. Not municipal sewage, if the distinction makes sense. On that basis, according to his figures, if we take the per capita biogas of Germany as being 100% and compare it, we're down at that end of the scale at 1%. We have four times the population, and we have one quarter of the number of digesters. As of 314 last year, Germany had 9,200 farm industrial scale digesters built, being constructed or planned, with a population of 80 million. And ours now is about 320. Comparable figures for the US and Canada are 400 digesters and 340 million. That's including Canada with the US. As many digesters, 4% as many digesters with a population that's four times larger. So why not the U.S.? What is it that's stopping us? Well, when you start talking about renewable energy, in a lot of instances you're talking about small scale. Your use would be small scale. The zoo would be fairly small scale, all right? This has a tendency to change the structure of society in certain ways. And society has a certain inertia. Yeah. So in sum, again, the basics are simple. Keep it warm, keep it wet, feed it the right way, and let nature take its course, biogas results. But wide United States use of biogas may not be as simple. In a society making decisions guided by reason and science and physics as one of the sciences, one would expect that we'd be producing a lot more biogas. Luckily, we have a government which is and promises to remain of, by, and for the people. This is a picture that was taken at a rally by CBS, I think, a CBS photographer. Please limit our internet freedom, stop giving us benefits from tax money, give our forests to timber companies, and so on. This is democracy in action.
It's a Republican National
Convention. That could be. A parenthetical comment, just in case we're inclined to feel smug, having taken such a cheap and satisfying shot at the United States, please note we do actually have a democracy. We really do. With the unfortunate consequence that the ultimate responsibility for whatever is right or wrong is actually the sum of what we as a people value. E pluribus unum is the phrase. You can find it on your dollar bill. And please realize also that any household which earns greater than or equal to $30,000 annually is in the top 1.5% of world incomes. If we're speaking of the 99%, we're the 99%. The median income in the U.S. is $51,000 plus some change. But staggering back towards the main point, I wanted to say also at this point, some people will say, yes, but corporations will do this, and politicians will say that, and I have to agree, they will, until we stop them, until we as a society change. And if you think change is not possible, really, consider, cast your mind back to 1950 and the way things were in this city, all right? And wind yourself forward. Or look at changing attitudes about gay marriage. All right, change is possible. It does happen, and it's going to go on. It's just a question of our having our impact. Here we have natural gas, oil, uranium, coal, right? These are sort of fixed and immutable in terms of how much there is. We don't really know how much there is. And so this actually is about proven reserves. proven or suspected reserves. Let's put it that way. Coal, obviously, we have just a heck of a lot of coal, not a lot of oil. And actually, if it makes a difference too, if you're a physicist, you'll notice that all the renewables are in terms of terawatts, and all of the stored non-renewables are in terms of terawatt years. But nevertheless, they're roughly comparable for a number of reasons. Solar, we get 23,000 terawatts a year. Now, it may not be possible to capture all of that, but you don't have to capture very much. Before you meet world energy consumption, you can see right in the middle there, 16 terawatts annually. All right? Geothermal, maybe 2 terawatts. Hydro, 3 to 4. Biomass, 2 to 6. Wind, 25 to 70. And solar, of course, is magnificent. All right, now this, I wouldn't call this proven fact, right? Because somebody did a study and this is what they came up with. But honest to gosh, it's hard to see how you could make a responsible argument that renewables won't work. You know, they will. It's just a question of shifting our mindset, shifting our economics, shifting our politics, shifting what we value ultimately that will make this happen. So what are the benefits of biogas? All right, and really I'm going to focus on two different contexts. One is here in the US and the other is overseas, where that gentleman who was sorting through the garbage lives. The USDA says the United States currently has more than 2,000 sites producing biogas. Now, you'll remember that the slide before, when we were talking about the number of digesters, said there were about 400. The difference is pretty much made up with municipal sewage digesters. So I think USDA here is taking all of those digesters into account, including municipal sewage digesters. That kind of corresponds the 400 with the 2,000, if you will, because there are about 1,500, 1,600 municipal sewage digesters in the U.S. The roadmap, this is the USDA's roadmap for biogas, found that with proper support, more than 11,000 additional biogas systems could be deployed in the U.S. If fully realized, these systems could produce enough energy to power more than 3 million American homes and reduce methane emissions equivalent to 4 to 54 million metric tons. That's quite a range, but they're dealing with a lot of estimates built on estimates. In 2030, the annual emissions of between 800,000 and 11 million passenger vehicles. Now, with reference to that last number, I would say that I'm pretty certain the USDA was using an old number for the global warming potential of methane, which for many, many years has been thought to be about 21 to 28, 25 maybe. It's historically embedded, for example, in the carbon market. If you gain money by reducing carbon dioxide equivalent using methane, they'll give you about 25 tons of carbon dioxide credit for 1 ton of methane. But it turns out, more recent research shows that the global warming potential of methane is much higher than that. And therefore, I think that if USDA were to make this last calculation, the 800,000 to 11 million, a broad range, but nevertheless, they would multiply it by about 4. In Oregon, we take Oregon as an example. Oregon has the feedstock industry infrastructure to generate over 100 megawatts of biogas electricity. It currently only has 8 megawatts installed. So what is that, 12 times? According to the latest figures from EPA, this is the AgStar program, and they list only manure-fed digesters. Don't ask me why. I called them up and asked them. They didn't know either. But they only list manure-fed digesters. There's a digester south of me in Corvallis that's vegetarian. Generates lots of biogas. Oregon has twice the number of digesters per capita as the average in the U.S., and on that basis, we would assume the U.S. as a whole may be able to generate 25 times more electricity from biogas. And generating electricity with biogas turns out to be very efficient, at least in terms of physics. The reason is this, that when you're running an engine, the proper kind of engine with biogas, the heat that's generated in the radiator water can get fed back into the digester to keep it warm. And so when you look at the efficiency of the whole system, it runs about 80%, depending. If you get larger larger engines, larger cogen sets, then the efficiency goes up some. To return to anthropogenic global warming, besides improving our energy picture and not coincidentally closing the fertility circle by returning digested materials to the land, individuals who make biogas can have an important impact on anthropogenic global warming. Let's take a look at four data points that pertain. A lot of food is being wasted. Something between a third and a half of all food globally is wasted. And some of this, you know, is unavoidable. I mean, you can eat the cereal in the morning and there's bound to be a little film of milk or something. Some people throw the milk away. I don't. I put it in my coffee, I drink it, but that's me. But it's hard not to waste some food. We waste actually a lot more than we should. The National Resources Defense Fund estimates that 40% of the food in the U.S. is wasted. You can find lots of these estimates, but this is about the sweet spot in terms of where they cluster. A study released by USDA last year asserted that 1,250 calories per capita per day in the food supply in 2010 went uneaten. And this pertains, of course, to causes and its program and so on. That's a pretty important number. I don't know what it is, but it's 1,600 calories for, you know, and you can eat 12, you could survive on 1,250, lose a little weight, I could stand that. But that's amazing if you think about it. Per capita. This is wastage per capita. It demonstrates, I think, that hunger, in fact, not just in the U.S., but worldwide, is not a matter of how much food we grow. We probably grow enough and can grow enough food, but it's systemic, it's economic, it's structural, much more. Meanwhile, 1 in 6 people in America face hunger. This is against this enormous waste. So, second data point is wasted food can produce methane. The decomposition of food and other organic waste in landfills produces methane, a greenhouse gas much more damaging to the environment than carbon dioxide. Landfills are the largest human-related source of methane in the U.S., accounting for 34% of all methane emissions.
Wow.
It's a lot. Yeah. It's one thing to throw it away. It's something else, again, to put it in a landfill. As only some of that is captured, and it's just the wrong place to put the food if you're going to throw it away. In fact, food waste makes a lot of good biogas, or if you will, a lot of bad methane. All right, here's a picture. This is from some German data. I can share the source with you if you want. But this is about the different kinds of, the different amounts of biogas that you can produce on a dry pound of whatever it is. Well, now, in terms of the sociology of biogas, people assume you should make biogas out of manure. And obviously the EPA does, because as I said a little while ago, their list of digesters in the U.S. is only manure-fed digesters. And certainly that's good. I'm not arguing that it's not good. But there are better things to use to make biogas. So, for example, per unit dry weight, food waste produces almost 9 times more biogas and therefore almost 9 times more methane per dry pound than cow manure. There's a gold mine waiting for us.
We're already handling it.
I hope so. Third data point, methane is a potent greenhouse gas. Recent research shows that methane is a much more powerful greenhouse gas than was previously suspected. 105 times the global warming potential is CO2. Now this is done on a per weight basis, right? So a mole of any gas is about 22 liters, gram molecular weight. If you have a ton of CO2, it's got a certain global warming potential or forcing effect on the environment. Methane, a ton of methane, has 105 times the impact of CO2. And it would have a lot greater impact except for the fact that methane over time gets degraded in the environment. All right, the standard is to think about the impact of a gas over a century, if you look at the physics of global warming. And these are the numbers that we often use for these kinds of gases. If you shorten that time horizon, obviously the impact goes up, right, for methane. This study was over a 20-year time horizon. And I don't think it's a bad way to look at it, at least for a gas like methane, because it decomposes. All right, you're talking more about actual impact and less about sort of a comparable figure, if you will. The fourth data point, this equals big problems. The UN Food and Agriculture Organization says that food waste ranks as the third top emitter after the USA and China. All right, you can take a country and all of their emissions, and you can rank those countries. Now, a lot of the emissions that they produce is going to be from wasted food, right? If you sort of take all of that wasted food and pretend that it's its own country, it's third after China and the USA. All right, so a lot of our problem with climate change is being produced by wasted food. And this is why it's such an interesting target for this kind of process. In terms of greenhouse gases anyway, there are other reasons. The Environmental Defense Fund says that about 25% of the man-made global warming we're experiencing today is caused by methane emissions. So, what's the summation? We're wasting a lot of food in the U.S., somewhere near a pound per person per day. All right, this is where I want to tell you that you will never hear me say, except in a context like this, home biogas. Because, unfortunately, we don't produce enough waste in any average home to feed a biogas digester in order to extract enough biogas. When we're talking about individual use of biogas, in my opinion, what we're talking about is going out and finding, either living on a farm and growing something, or trading with your neighbor, raising cows, whatever, or we're talking about going out and finding a source of material which is good to make biogas. And food waste, as you saw, is 9 times better than manure. So if you want to spend a day hunting for a manure source, spend 9 days searching for food waste. All right, now, because it'll make 9 times the amount of biogas, food waste will. So, you obviously don't want to drive too far, because you've still got the economics and the energetics of this, right? It doesn't make any sense to turn gasoline into biogas. But many people are in a situation where they might be able to do this. You won't be able to do it in an apartment, right? Cubic foot of water is 62 pounds. A biogas digester that's large enough to produce your cooking fuel is going to weigh about a ton. You don't want to put that on your balcony in an apartment. But some people do have a circumstance and situation where they'll be able to make use of biogas. And I will try my level best, either in a situation like this or in the workshop, to give you the straight information. Some of it might be discouraging. You might be discouraged by knowing that you can't do this in an apartment, or it's unlikely to do it in an apartment. Nevertheless, that's just the facts. We do not generate enough waste per person to make much biogas, but if we aggregate the food waste from 10 to 15 people, we will have enough biogas to cook all of our family meals, just for example. Collect from more people and make more biogas. You can pick up from the grocery store, from the fast food outlet, from many, many places. At least you can today.
For the energy for one family?
No, cooking. Cooking our family meals out of the food waste from 10 to 15 people. That's based on a little less than a pound per day per person.
A family of four cooking for them would need 10 to 15 people.
Yes. Right. Which is why, for example, a kitchen will never generate its own biogas simply out of the food waste that it's producing. Right? Because it, you know, you add more people, you also add more cooking time at exactly the same ratio. You just never quite get there. But if that kitchen is on a farm and they're growing their own food, then they're going to be generating more waste, right? When we eat corn for our meal, what do we have left over? A package. All right, but if you're getting it off the farm, you have the cob, the stalk, the leaves. All right, so it depends on your situation. But in general, it's about a little less than a pound per day, and that's not enough to generate much biogas. And human waste is not very good either. In terms of generating biogas, the waste from one person, it will give you about 600 BTUs. It's less than the amount of energy that I expend in an hour standing up here talking. All right, so not a lot of energy. And if you put human waste in your digester, then you'll turn it into a biohazard. Lots of people with pens and clipboards will show up and start asking difficult questions. So you may not want to do that. My aim is to assist in catalyzing the use of food waste in the U.S. in a manner similar to the way that the biodiesel movement catalyzed the use of used cooking oil. Not everybody makes biodiesel. But you can't find used cooking oil anymore. 20 years ago, it was impossible to get rid of, right? If you've ever dealt with it, you know how difficult it can be. It clogged the drains, it was expensive to get it hauled away, and so on. A nuisance. Now it's valuable. And food waste, to a large degree now, is in the same position. That's why it's possible for a few dedicated crazies to make biogas. The value of addressing the issue of food waste in the U.S., diverting it toward human consumption before, and converting it to making biogas after disposal, becomes obvious once you know the facts. Interestingly, in the developing world, even more food is wasted, at least according to the data I've seen, and the problems are more severe. And it makes sense, actually, in the developing world. Yet the benefits of biogas are multiplied. It makes sense that more food is wasted, right? Because they have less refrigeration, they have poorer roads, right? There's a lot of reasons. But yes, more food is wasted. So, right, we just talked about the benefits in the U.S., which I think to a large degree center around this issue of global warming. Now we're going to talk about the benefits in the developing world. Biogas is known in many development circles as a strong catalyst for development. Take wood smoke, for example. Around 3 billion people cook and heat their homes using open fires and simple stoves burning biomass. 4.3 million people annually die prematurely from illness attributable to the household air pollution from cooking. That's 6.5 times the population of D.C. annually. Globally, it's nearly 12,000 people every day. And of course, when that many die, many, many more must be sick, suffering debilitating illness. More than 50% of premature deaths among children under 5 are due to pneumonia caused by particulate matter inhaled from household air pollution. This is black carbon, soot. It's not, scientifically speaking, a greenhouse gas, but it has a very important effect on anthropogenic global warming. Studies show that often as much as 6 hours a day is required for one family member to cut and gather firewood for forest retreat from villages that are consuming them. You can see it on a map often. And what's happening is that every year you have to walk further. Who's doing the walking? Often the eldest girl is sent out for firewood. Now that's a job. That's going to be her job if she has to do that. 6 hours a day, what else are you going to do? Where a family gains a digester, she has time to be educated, breaking the cycle of poverty, because at base poverty is ignorance, and the mother is the first teacher of the children. Less wood burn means less deforestation, because many regions and countries do not manage their forests sustainably. Now, it turns out to be a really complex question as to what the impact on global warming is of simple cooking fires, right? Because there's all kinds of interaction, for example, with black carbon in the environment. It's not well understood yet how much that impact is, but it's thought to be dramatic. Likewise, there's the release of carbon dioxide where it's not regrown in forests and so on. Carbon that's burnt, being liberated, not recaptured. I don't know if I have the statistic, but some people think it could be as much as 20% of all global warming attributable to 3 rock fires. People in huts, cooking food. Biogas can offer an escape from energy poverty and reduce expenses where it replaces kerosene or LPG. And when it replaces coal, that's a dramatic difference because coal is carcinogenic. Coal smoke. Biogas produces far better light than wood or kerosene. This has implications for women doing handwork in the evening. They can improve their incomes. All right, and for children reading, they can improve their education. So that's what it looks like if you have a candle, and I assume that's a fairly long exposure, right? It might actually be brighter in the photograph than it is in as our eyes would perceive it. In fact, you can see that's a long exposure because there's no flame, it's sort of a glow. But here's what a biogas light can produce, you know? Even 6, 8, 10 feet away from that light, you could still read. Do your homework.
Does that have a mantle in it?
Yes, it does, like a Coleman, yes. When one of the other differences is the candle is sort of freestanding, right?
Yeah.
You're walking around, you knock it over. What do you think might happen if it goes into that back wall there? You'd have a fire. And it's not hard to find pictures of people who've been severely burned, most of them children, by such fires. Whereas the biogas lamp is fixed, so it doesn't produce that kind of danger. It doesn't have that kind of danger. Gender equality is another benefit that results. With improved health, increased time, better light, women can generate a larger fraction of the family income. And when they do, of course, that has its implications. Thus, likewise, families, then villages and regions, can improve their economic status. So this is a partial list of the benefits. Eliminate wood smoke, improving health and saving lives. Save time from gathering wood, cooking, cleaning pots. You know, those fires really blacken the pots, and a lot of people spend a lot of time cleaning them. Reducing deforestation, reduce black carbon and energy expenses. Eliminate energy poverty, offer better light, improve income, increase gender equality. Is your mouth falling open? Mine is when I realized that this was the case with biogas. Improve educational outcomes, catalyzing an escape from poverty. Now, at this point, I think we should all applaud biogas. I'm already standing. You're welcome to stand up if you want. Yay, biogas!
Yeah.
Go, biogas! Go, go! All right. Thank you. In sum, what this means is that biogas can be a kind of an engine for prosperity in the developing world. Given all this, the natural question is, why isn't biogas used more often? And the answer is the cost of present designs for biogas digesters is rather high. The lowest generally quoted price for digester is about $350. And if you include all the programmatic costs, you know, the carpet and the computers and the what have you, it can go up to $700 per digester. Consider that in the year 2000, about 60% of the Indian population had an annual household income of less than $280. Now, how are you going to buy a biogas digester at $350 when that's more than your annual income? You know, we speak of discretionary income, but when you're making $280, you don't have any discretionary income. You've got to buy food and maybe you can't even buy shoes. How are you going to buy a biogas digester? So what happens? Even when these digesters are subsidized, they are given to those who are already in the middle class. And here's the irony. Because they have animals, the animals generate manure. The manure is thought of as the best fuel for the biogas digester. But I showed you that it's not. It's not the best fuel for the biogas digester. It's much better to grow plants and actually to ensile them, silage, if you know what that is. Because then you've got a reliable source of energy, right? The plants grow up, and in the springtime, they're great. You cut, make silage. That silage can fuel that digester for a long time. I mentioned the guy south of me in Corvallis who's got a vegetarian digester. That's what he does. He farms 5,000 acres organically, and when he harvests, he brings all that back to the factory that he has on the farm, including corn stalks, grinds it all up, the pumpkin vines, the rinds, whatever it is. And then when he needs more biogas, he starts to put that stuff into the digester. Meanwhile, it's ensiled. It's kind of a natural process for stopping fermentation and decomposition. Because the pH drops, the acidity increases, then there's no biology that can take place in that material. But it's perfect. It's sort of partially digested and really ready to make good biogas. Silage is basically the first part of a cow, if you want to think about it that way, or any ungulate, ruminant, right? They chew up their food, so it's got a certain amount of moisture. And what happens is, because there isn't a lot of water, you don't get quite the same process. It goes acidic. The pH drops. Now, when the pH drops below about 6.5, 6, then the rest of the biology that keeps breaking down that material into organic chemicals and eventually to carbon dioxide and methane, the most reduced and the most oxidized forms of carbon, respectively, that biology is sort of frozen in place because things are so acidic. All right, so silage is a natural process which has been used for centuries by peoples to store food for their animals. And again, it's sort of partially digested. Really, a biogas digester can be thought of as a concrete cow. And so just as you could feed it to cows, you can put it in your digester, and it makes great biogas. The difference with compost is that it's got a little bit more moisture, and usually you keep it aerated. Do forgive me for not mentioning, but silage is anaerobic. The oxygen gets used up by the biology, and you don't let any more oxygen in. That's crucial. Because if you let the oxygen in, there's a shift in biology which can take place, even in those drier environments. Exclude the oxygen, it goes acidic, and silage is one result. All right, so we were talking about the developed world and about why these digesters, which have all these benefits, right? We all applauded spontaneously. It was spontaneous, wasn't it, applause? We all applauded for biogas because it has all these benefits, but it's not being used to conquer poverty because the cost of these digesters is so high. The poor don't benefit simply because they're too poor. They're so poor they can't escape from their So we're therefore developing a digester. This is the royal we. We're developing a digester design which is to be mass-produced. It's liable to economies of scale. Early prototypes cost $12 in materials versus $350. To that must be added the cost of labor, a percentage for overhead and profit. In other words, it may be possible to distribute digesters to the poor for a cost of perhaps $25 to $30. Now, I'm in a sense comparing apples with oranges because the $350 digesters are underground, they're masonry, they last 20 years. These guys might last 2. But if every 2 years you have to pay $25, that's something that's much more doable for the poor. And likewise, if it's easier to purchase, it's easier to subsidize as well. The cost of the subsidy can be so low, particularly if the organization that's subsidizing is also manufacturing, that it becomes possible for the poor, the really poor, to benefit from that, even folks that don't have animals. Likewise, with a cost that low, if you can demonstrate to other people, yes, we can sell digesters, this is a business, then it can go viral, and the ordinary mechanisms of capitalism can help produce this. So this is what one of these digesters looks like. It's pretty simple. All right, this particular one, because it's a prototype and evolving design, I haven't been using UV-resistant plastic, but that's not difficult. And I used to, in the workshops, I used to show people how to build these, because this is my passion. Where I want to be is out in the jungle, helping people build these. But what I realized was that you can't get people really interested unless they got something they can use. People love to build these, and it's a lot of fun, and it's very easy. But then they were kind of disappointed when they said, now what do I do with it? You can't use this in the U.S. because you have to insulate it here. It's too cold. So I decided to shift to making, and I'm in the middle of that shift, going to these new digesters that I briefly described, and I'll talk quite a bit more about in the workshop. So the essence of both the problems and the solutions in this instance is not technological. When you're distributing these kinds of digesters to the poor, neither the problems nor the solutions are essentially technological. All right? The new design for biogas digesters is both necessary and insufficient to address the problems. What's needed is to distribute such a technology using an approach which is culturally sensitive, which fosters dignity, which is embedded in justice, and which emphasizes education and support. If you look at the statistics in China, I've got a great picture of Mao, Chairman Mao, looking at a teapot boiling because it's on a biogas flame. Mao actually got interested in 58, 56 in biogas. And so, of course, he said, you know, do it. I mean, he was an emperor. Nobody ever says that, but he was an emperor, right? If he said, you live, you die, that's the way. So he said, make biogas happen. And they did. They ran out into the countryside and they started building digesters. And if you look at a graph of the number of digesters in China, you'll see it goes like this. All right, because finally people got honest and they went back and they said, are you using your digester? And the guy says, no. Because they got no support. Some little thing went wrong. They didn't understand it. The technology was insufficient. They also required some education, some hand-holding. You show up and say, how's Aunt Tilda? Is her arthritis a little better? And the guy feels better about biogas as a result, and he uses his digester. So now it's beginning to climb again in China, Nepal, India. There may be 30 million of these masonry digesters that are out there already installed in the world. That sounds like a lot, but in terms of market penetration, it's still pretty low, right, in terms of the need for these. And as I said, virtually all of these digesters are being provided to the middle class, so they're not touching the poor. Describing such a program would lead us into another subject entirely, the philosophy, ethics, and practical aspects of development work. For now, therefore, let me say thank you for listening.
Thank you for watching this special lecture series from the College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences of the University of the District of Columbia. As your public land grant university, we are committed to conducting research and offering programs that improve the quality of life and economic opportunity in the District of Columbia and the global community. Our academic programs are relevant and practical, and the research-based community education programs in our 5 land grant centers are making a difference in the lives of the people and organizations whom they serve. This happens because we not only teach in classrooms and laboratories and architecture studios on our campuses, but you will find the Causes team teaching in public schools, religious centers, community gardens, and farmers markets in every ward of the District of Columbia. If you would like more information, please visit our college online at www.udc.edu/causes. I'm Sabine O'Hara. Thank you for watching, and join us again for another Causes lecture.